Are there phenomena capable of destroying the Earth or human species in seconds? Many. What options do we as humans have if that happens? The conquest of space is the next step that we must take as a species, not only because of the economic benefits that space mining can present, but because it is the best way to ensure our survival. In this conquest towards the last frontier, there is an idea that has gained strength in recent decades: terraforming. Terraforming a celestial body means molding it so that it can sustain life as we know it, and make a planet equal to, or at least similar to, Earth. Although this has been explored a lot in science fiction, we are increasingly approaching the technological threshold to consider the terraforming of planets and moons a reality. Indeed, you've heard a lot about terraforming Mars, but little about the Moon, and it's normal to hear about bombarding it with water-filled meteors as if this would be an easy task, looking to turn it blue and then green. But how true is this? What can we do to terraform the Moon? And is it viable? Let's find out. Challenges and resources required to terraform the Moon. Working on terraforming the Moon has one significant advantage over any other planets in our solar system: distance. Compared to Mars or Venus, the most common candidates, you can communicate practically in real time with people on the Moon. The logistics necessary for the task are greatly facilitated. However, not all of them are advantages, because each planet or the Moon is different. To live anywhere on the universe requires us to fulfill specific basic needs: food, water, breathable air, and shelter from radiation. This means that the first thing we need is an atmosphere, something that the Moon in principle does not have, because of the solar wind that would sooner or later rip apart any gases that could form on the surface. The lunar magnetic field. The first thing that must be solved is the absence of a magnetic field, so that the solar wind won't snatch away any of the atmosphere that we can create. Since our satellite is tiny and has no active tectonic plates, thinking about activating or reactivating a dynamo in its core is not a good idea. Instead, a high-powered magnetic field generator can be installed to enter a parallel, fixed orbit concerning the Moon. This can be achieved by placing this magnetic generator at the first Lagrange point, which is an area in which the gravitational pull of celestial bodies is counteracted, so that an object spiraling downward to the Sun can be maintained as a fixed point in space by being pulled by other bodies such as the Moon and Earth. This equipment would require large amounts of energy, but large solar panels can provide this, since they would be most effective where there is no atmosphere. At the same time, that could facilitate us to install a series of mirrors that can concentrate the Sun's energy towards the Moon, giving us an abundant source of energy for the activities we must do on or beneath the surface. Another need that this achievement would cover would be an improvement in the quality of human life throughout the process, since solar wind and the radiation that it brings can very negatively affect the health of astronauts after prolonged exposure, even increasing the odds of cancer. Water, atmosphere, and temperature. Once we don't have to worry about the solar wind and radiation, we can concentrate on forming a lunar atmosphere and carrying water to the Moon. It should be clarified that causing meteorite impacts can be a terrible idea. First of all, while in theory you could make controlled impacts of meteors rich in water or other materials that we need, the logistics of going to an asteroid belt and accurately diverting one from its existing gravitational path makes this solution very expensive and excessively slow. No, we need something faster. Suppose the calculations go wrong, or certain factors are not considered when modeling the impact trajectories towards the Moon. A lousy collision could expel gases, water, and materials into space, losing the atmosphere gains and all the time it took to accomplish. Not to mention that it could put human lives at risk. Turning to see the Moon's resources may be a better idea. For example, during the last decades, it has been detected that the Moon has water in the form of ice on its surface, especially in those areas where sunlight does not reach, such as craters or shadows generated by the rocky relief, something that has been suggested by multiple investigations. Still, it has also been shown that lunar rocks collected in the Apollo missions are hydrated, So you could get water from these, as according to Alexander Basilevsky, a planetary geologist at the Russian Academy of Sciences. Suppose we can take advantage of the sun's energy with solar panels and burners. In that case, we can obtain energy to carry out electrolysis processes with lunar rocks and gradually take the elements that we have at hand on the surface. In their latest unified geological map of the Moon, the United States Geological Survey, or USGS, in conjunction with NASA, has interpreted a silicate-filled surface where getting oxygen wouldn't be a problem. If you have a lot of oxygen in the rocks and lunar regolith, you can use the hydrogen from space to create water. The process is what Alexander Basilevsky mentions as the first water former on the Moon. However, this water could be volatile and easily escape into space by being bombarded by the sun's high-energy particles, disintegrating the water molecules back into hydrogen and oxygen, unless they can find refuge in craters and permanently shadowed areas of the Moon where ice sheets are thought to be found, from the poles to the equator, which can provide precious resource relatively at hand. Also, these electrolysis processes will necessarily involve a generation of heat to the environment. So, when we create or capture oxygen and water, we could be releasing heat relatively slowly but safely. We have already experienced a warming planet after all. One problem that remains to be addressed is the little presence detected in the lunar rocks of nitrogen and carbon, essential elements for life, and found only in parts per million on the Moon. However, this could be not entirely true, since the samples we have are not from the entire Moon, which can cover up local rock deposits that do not have these elements, an idea that is gaining strength, since it has been detected that samples of carbon ions are being emitted in more significant quantities than expected in the basaltic mines, according to the data from the Japanese mission of the lunar orbiter Kaguya. If this is confirmed for carbon, it would give us hope for nitrogen or facilitate logistics by importing fewer elements into the lunar atmosphere. Gravity. The main problem of planetoids and satellites in terms of terraforming is their lack of gravity. It is usually fantasized about a full moon of water and waves 20 meters high with people who can fly with little equipment due to the low gravity. A lunar Florida, as it were. But currently, this is only a fantasy. In reality, low gravity has two serious problems. The first is that it involves health problems for settlers or future inhabitants, although we do not know this for sure. Many astronauts have experienced shallow gravity on the International Space Station or in space traveling. Still, the Moon has gravity, 1/6 of the Earth's, but it is better than nothing, and the effects of bone and muscle loss may not present themselves in the same way. Despite that, you can kill two birds with one stone by placing pieces of lead in astronauts' suits to increase their weight and protect them from radiation. Or you can decrease this problem with plenty of exercise and special facilities for sports and sleep, facilities that keep the body feeling the Earth's gravity when sleeping. However, the real problem of low gravity in terraforming is much more severe, since combined with solar wind, it prevents the Moon from retaining the gases with which we would build its atmosphere. It has been estimated that we could only retain them for about 10,000 years, forcing us to create a giant dome that keeps the atmosphere contained inside, or constantly generates new gases to replace those that escape into space, a problem that greatly complicates any immediate hopes for terraforming. On the other hand, maintaining the idea of bombarding the Moon with meteors, asteroids, and comets to make it gain mass and better retain a future atmosphere not only increases the risks already mentioned above, but perhaps it would not be a good idea for life on Earth if our satellite has more and more mass. Increasing it would attract more meteors and asteroids. In addition, the effects on the tides could be devastating, affecting the lives of many human beings who live on the coasts and the value chains of energy infrastructures, enlarging the problem in large quantities. So, if there is no way to make the Moon have more mass and the atmosphere will be lost anyway, is it even possible at all to terraform the Moon? No, at least not with current technology. But there is no need to give up hope just yet. Lunar colonization. As we theoretically face the challenges of lunar terraforming, researchers have found more and more objects of interest both in a scientific sense and an economic one, and the Moon may still have many untold secrets. We must remember that the Apollo missions were motivated by politics rather than science, which meant that the landing sites did not have planning that favored scientific research. Hence, knowing better the resources that the Moon has is fundamental. There is already a program of lunar exploration, exploitation, and commercialization working hard to return to the Moon and conduct experiments that test what has been found so far, and commercial arrangements like the Artemis program, led by NASA, but in which multiple space agencies participate. Suppose the logistical capacity to exploit lunar resources is achieved and economically worthwhile deposits such as rare earth elements are discovered. In that case, this program will grow and competition may arise, starting with space mining. If this happens, creating industry and human habitats to operate these industries will become a priority, and we will apply everything learned to generate these habitats. Perhaps in large craters we can install a dome, take advantage of the water they have, and import some land, carbon, and nitrogen in specific areas for the livelihood of workers through a lunar crop. Solar panels, heaters, and ovens can be used to generate enough energy. Additionally, mining on the Moon will carry out the electrolysis processes. Since the days last for weeks on the Moon, another option to create shelters for humans would be to dig out caverns a few meters deep where, during the day, there will be naturally a pleasant temperature for humans. We can take advantage of energy stored during the day and at night. These activities may gradually extend until colonization is an undeniable fact. This colonization has other advantages in addition to the economic ones, since the Moon can be used as a base of space operations to other satellites and planets, as the low gravity entails a lower cost for any launch. The necessary infrastructure will begin to exist due to the economic needs anyway, making this proposal even more profitable in theory. The in-situ resources, and especially the water reserves that the Moon has, will facilitate the production of rocket fuel if we continue with the same technology in the first place. At the same time, there is a planet that is very similar in many ways to the Moon, but that has greater gravity and a much greater energy supply. A planet on which the same techniques that we have explored can be used and would have greater possibility of being terraformed. Mercury. Working on lunar terraforming will make us gain experience and open the door to terraforming of other similar satellites, where the solar wind and gravitational context are more beneficial for the task, expanding in turn the potential of space mining. Perhaps we can't terraform every celestial body in our solar system, at least not for now, but achieving it would be the most remarkable human feat. Finally, the human being would be taking the first steps in the right direction to become a space colonizing species. It will take time to get used to these activities. And while we should never look down on ethical and social questions, colonizing the Moon until self-sustainability in artificial habitats is possible, it is the necessary next step for our survival, and at the same time, the natural next step for our species.